Let's talk about the news that has sent a lot of networking companies down in the past week or so. NVIDIA announced that Meta and Oracle are using Spectrum X Ethernet. Is this something we need to be worried about?
Oh, totally. It is time to freak out, everybody.
Thanks, everybody, for coming back to Chipstock Investor, sponsor of today's video, Fiscal.ai, showing you this chart that we're going to talk about later on free cash flow per share.
This is a really important financial metric that still does not get a lot of attention. But if you're a serious investor, you need to know about free cash flow per share. And Fiscal.ai has the metric built into its platform. So it's easy to use, to calculate, and to implement in your valuation metrics when assessing businesses like these ones.
You can get 15% off any paid plan using the link here in the video or in the description, fiscal.ai/CSI, 15% off any paid plan.
What is Spectrum X?
It's a great question.
Help us out here.
Here's some of the products that NVIDIA has that are for networking. There it is, Quantum X InfiniBand and Spectrum X Ethernet on the very bottom. Switching and network chips that are related and related interconnects to stitch together computing nodes. So a lot of that is GPU to GPU primarily at this point.
Yeah, and Quantum X is the InfiniBand product. That's the technology that's proprietary, sort of proprietary to NVIDIA that they acquired via Mellanox. And then Spectrum X is the open standards Ethernet-based systems. So we'll discuss what that means here as we go through. BlueField and NVLink are different types of interconnect technologies that we have addressed in previous work, and we're going to skip that for now. This is NVIDIA's Q2, the last reported quarter, which is pretty good. The networking business did pretty darn good, right?
Yeah, it more than doubled in that year since last summer. And so we knew that this was happening, that networking was becoming a big part of the business. Most of the networking business, as we mentioned, is directly to the GPU to GPU interconnects.
InfiniBand.
InfiniBand. So here we are again talking about it. And the worry is, again, that this Ethernet Spectrum X is going to be a problem for the networking companies.
If we have to pin a story to why Arista Network stock was down last Friday and earlier this week, this is it. We shouldn't pin this narrative to the stock price, though. Let's just talk about what's happening removed from the stock price move itself. We did that series of articles, a public video or two about it a year ago now, about Arista Networks. And lo and behold, even after NVIDIA announced Spectrum X Ethernet-based systems, which is a competitor to what Arista does, because Arista doesn't do InfiniBand, they do Ethernet, open standards, networking systems. I mean, I don't know. It looks pretty good to me based on this chart. This is their revenue excluding software services. So just products. Homing in pretty quickly on $2 billion per quarter in those sales of networking systems. Not bad. And that's including the fact that Arista competes in a pretty crowded space. Right? They have a lot of competitors in these Ethernet-based systems.
And what we're talking about here is NVIDIA has grown their networking business because of taking market share from, not from Arista, but by acquisition by Mellanox, right?
Most of what NVIDIA does and their inclusion on this list that we put together is via InfiniBand, which is proprietary to NVIDIA and a different technology. Think of it almost like NVIDIA networking, which is proprietary to NVIDIA, is for AI training. And then Spectrum X, the new Ethernet-based system that does compete with all of these companies, Arista included, is Ethernet, which is used for data center front end or inference. Let's just call it AI inference. It's an oversimplification. Data centers are really big, complex things, but that's basically what's going on. NVIDIA is starting to compete now, starting to actually compete and pick up some sales and revenue against some of these older providers of Ethernet-based systems.
Okay, let's talk about Arista's portfolio. And they span just about every type of application, small business, large business, cloud, data center, small campus. They have an engineering solution and the software to go with it.
The software that Arista builds and ships with these systems is best in class. And it's what gives Arista the platform ability to go out and make these bolt-on acquisitions. Like last quarter, when we talked about their acquisition of the old VMware, basically call it the SASE product from VMware that Broadcom decided was not critical to its business. And so sold off for a few $100 million to Arista. Nice fit for Arista. Great use of their $8-9 billion in cash sitting on balance, in spite of the share buybacks that they continue to do. Great. Fantastic business model.
And we don't want to forget who partners with Arista, the very large partner in Broadcom.
And then, of course, we're going to get to the Oracle and OpenAI thing here in a moment, because this is pertinent to Arista Networks as well. We can infer, based on some announcements that Broadcom has made, that Arista is participating in those deals as well. But so, yes, we have NVIDIA competing with Arista, but Arista's not kind of like on this island floundering, trying to figure out how to stave off NVIDIA. They have a very, very powerful partners like Broadcom.
This post was from last year, and this is when Broadcom at the same time announced their 800G networking chips that helped band together hundreds of thousands of XPUs. Arista unveiled their new Etherlink AI networking platform.
Same press release. This was shortly after Broadcom had announced the Tomahawk 5 switch chip. And so now we are continuing on with Tomahawk 6. Maybe briefly to touch on the technical networking architecture here a bit. Tomahawk series from Broadcom is a switch chip. And so network switching is what allows for scale up, as they call. So like fitting more XPUs into a single rack. And then the Jericho series, Jericho 4 is the routing chip that allows for scale out. So multiple cabinets and systems to be linked together. And that's what creates these hundreds of thousands of GPU clusters for NVIDIA InfiniBand. And now using Ethernet and Broadcom chips and Arista chips, hundreds of thousands of XPUs. This slide here is actually taken from March of 2024. It was the same week NVIDIA was having its GTC 2024. Broadcom had its own AI event, and it talked about all of the companies that it is partnering with to develop XPUs and the ultimate hyperscalers that are currently in development or in production with their XPUs. Of course, not on this list. At the bottom there, they have Meta, Microsoft, and Oracle listed. The big one, the big XPU customer, though, of course, is Google, and its TPUs, Tensor Processing Units. That is a type of application-specific integrated circuit, and it's a type of XPU. They've been working on those with Broadcom since 2015, probably prior to 2015, but they started shipping in 2015. But a couple of quotes here, because obviously now everybody is aware of Broadcom's big XPU business and the partnership that it has with Arista in deploying these systems with Arista's networking routers and switches that help interconnect all these XPUs. So this is back in March 2025 during the Q1 update. CEO Hock Tan of Broadcom said that beyond the main three customers that were currently shipping XPUs at the time, they had two other hyperscalers that were currently in development of their own custom accelerator. And then in addition to that, they had two additional hyperscalers select Broadcom for XPU work for a total of four potential future customers. And that's what originally led Hock Tan and the team to make this very, very large estimated SAM, serviceable addressable market, of $60 to $90 billion by 2027. Now let's fast forward 6 months. This is the last update that we got just last month. Hock Tan said that, you know, $110 billion backlog for Broadcom. This is before Oracle actually had their big RPO announcement. So Broadcom kind of got there first, but they mentioned their semiconductor revenue up 26% year over year, driven by this AI business, AI semiconductor business, which was up 63% year over year. Continuing with the quote, they had mentioned that one of those four customers that was in development decided to go ahead with actual production. They got their fourth XPU customer and secured $10 billion worth of orders for those AI racks, those XPU-based computing racks. Everybody thought at the time that must be OpenAI, except Broadcom semiconductor head, Charlie Kawas, actually just said yesterday, no, OpenAI is not a hyperscaler. So the OpenAI announcement that was made in the last couple of days is actually an additional customer. So Broadcom actually has four hyperscalers that they're working with on these XPUs based on Ethernet systems, open source Ethernet systems, and now also OpenAI. Broadcom is doing some pretty incredible work here, and Arista Networks is more than just along for the ride. They are helping develop these systems using Broadcom's work to develop the switches and routers. And so they're very much participating in this Ethernet-based XPU business for the hyperscalers, over and above what the hyperscalers are already doing with NVIDIA InfiniBand systems, and now more recently, the Spectrum X Ethernet systems. And so now let's maybe talk about that $60 to $90 billion market, XPU market, in a year and a quarter, basically, at this point, starting in 2027. Here's the selected list of customers that are in at the time. This is, again, going back to March 2024. The actual known customers and the customers in development with Broadcom. So who was that fourth hyperscaler? It might have been ByteDance, TikTok. It could have been Alibaba or Tencent. It's hard to say because of all the train stuff happening and negotiations, restrictions on technology. So it could have actually been Oracle as well. Perhaps Oracle is developing an XPU in co-development with OpenAI. It's hard to say. Ultimately, I don't think it really matters. Hawk Dam was pretty adamant in saying they're not going to update the actual SAM just yet for 2027, but it's higher than it was stated in March of this year, 6 months ago. As these top hyperscalers continue to scale up and scale out and now also scale across, there's a lot of business available for Broadcom and Arista Networks as well. So NVIDIA is getting in on the party, but these guys are not defenseless against NVIDIA. They have a lot going for them.
And this is why the backlog is so big, right? This helps illustrate why that's a reasonable number that Broadcom has showed us or that Oracle has showed us, because these companies aren't just developing AI, they want to deploy it and they want to sell to consumers and businesses.
Yeah, AI inference. As we in some of the write-ups earlier this week, yesterday and on Monday, we mentioned that, and you maybe noticed starting to talk about some of this AI work, not just happening on the back end of the data center now, but moving forward to actual monetization. And so OpenAI is almost like a proxy for this. The last couple of years have been all about developing the AI. And now headed into 2026, we're looking at some very large growth in actual revenue from what the market likes to call AI revenue, even though on the back end of these data centers, it's very much AI revenue as well. We'll digress and we'll pander to the terminology here. Let's call it AI-specific revenue, generative AI-specific revenue. It's coming. It looks like it's coming in a very, very large tidal wave fashion starting right now. It's here.
Okay, so let's talk about, let's do two DCFs. And we'll base both of these on free cash flow per share. So let's start with Broadcom. Here's the free cash flow per share chart over the last 8 years. And here's a DCF. Sample reverse DCF, excuse me. So trailing 12 months, free cash flow per share of $5.16, 30% free cash flow per share growth for the next 5 years, using a 6% terminal growth rate thereafter, 10% discount rate gives us gets us to around $360 fair value for the current stock price. Is that a reasonable hurdle for Broadcom to clear?
That's up for you to decide. We've got lots of content out there on Broadcom to help you decide. Let's move to Arista.
Here's their chart for free cash flow per share. And here is a sample reverse DCF using $3.11 trailing 12 months, free cash flow per share, 20% free cash flow per share growth over the next 5 years, same terminal growth rate of 6%. Gets us to what the current price is for Arista, which is?
Let's say 140 to 150, because stock prices are volatile and they change. Is it reasonable? That's for you to decide. But I think the point of this, hopefully y'all picked up on this, you might be wondering about NVIDIA kind of raining on everybody's parade here in Ethernet-based networking. Broadcom and Arista are doing incredible work, and they are announcing big design wins with the hyperscalers. And so rather than thinking of this as, oh man, NVIDIA is coming for these guys, it's game over, think of this maybe more in terms of there's a lot of new business to go around in the coming years. And maybe if you need something other than just NVIDIA in your portfolio, Broadcom and Arista might still be worthy additions if they meet criteria for you. So round out your basket. You get a lot of good stuff. Of course, with Broadcom, you don't just get the semiconductor business. You also get the enterprise software, including VMware. And then Arista Networks, you also get something similar. You have the core hardware business, but you also have a lot of software services on top of that, cybersecurity that they're layering in, a great platform from which they can continue to drive per share profit growth for a long time.
Make sure you check out Semi Insider at chipstockinvestor.com. We have a lot of exciting things coming your way. Check it out.
And we'll be back shortly with more content this weekend. Make sure you hit that subscribe button, everybody. We appreciate it.